Hi, this is Dr. Shahriar Hussain. Today, we will discuss a way to find the optimal number of clusters, especially when we do not have any benchmark data. The question here is, given a dataset and no supervision, how can we figure out what number of clusters K is giving us the best results? We will apply the k-means clustering algorithm to the Pecan dataset. Using a score called silhouette coefficient, we will then evaluate the clustering result to find the optimal number of clusters. As you know, I'm focusing on the Python coding parts in this data science and machine learning workshop series. For the theory and the formulas of clustering evaluation techniques, I will provide a link to a page in the description section. Let us go to our Python case study to illustrate how to choose the number of clusters. Let's create a new notebook file. Let's name the file edaclust. I will import pandas as pd. Then I will read pecan.csv file. You are already familiar with the pecan.csv file from the previous video. It has 5 columns: row id, water per acre, salinity level, fertilizer per acre, and pecan yield. I will read the pecan.csv file from my Python code from this notebook. So I'm saying pd.read_csv. I'll be using this read_csv function to read pecan.csv. I know that the file has tab delimiters between columns. The readcsv function returns a data frame, and I am storing that data frame in a variable named df. Now, df contains the entire data set. If I print it, I'll be able to see the entire data set. I can see that it has row id, water per acre, salinity level, fertilizer per acre, and pecan yield. Of course, this first column 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 55, this column is a representation of indices for the rows. The actual columns in the data starts with row id, water per acre, so and so forth. So this particular column, this is actually added by pandas. The actual data part is this part. So I'll write df.info to see what are the names of the columns. So the columns names are row id, water per acre, salinity level, fertilizer per acre, pecan yield. From the analysis of the previous video, we already know that this row id column only contains some identification, and the numbers appear in a sequence starting from 1. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and these numbers will go up to 56 because there are 56 data points or rows in this Pecan dataset. If we want to go for any sort of clustering analysis, this row ID column is not important because it does not have the properties to distinguish one data point from another data point, because this is just a sequence of numbers representing what is the identity of this particular row. What we will do is we will remove this column row ID from our data frame. To do that, we can use the drop function. We can say df.drop, and in the parameter we can say which columns we want to remove. Here we just want to remove the row ID column. Now we have to use another parameter here to make sure that the column is actually removed. The other parameter is in place equals true. That means that the function will not just demonstrate a view of the removal, it will actually remove the row ID column from the data frame. So once we execute this line, this df.drop command with in place equals true, row ID will be gone from this df, this particular data frame. If we did not write this in place equals true, then the data frame will be displayed without row ID, but in reality, row ID would still stay in the data frame. So I'm running it with in place equals true. Now let's check, what do we have in df? Notice that previously we had the row ID column, but now we don't have any column named row ID. Our columns start from water per acre, then the next column is salinity level, fertilizer per acre, and then we have pecan yield. The row ID column is gone from df, from this particular data frame. df.info is also showing us that there is no column named row ID. The meaning is the row ID column has been removed. Now what we'll do is we will import the k-means clustering facilities from sklearn, from sklearn.cluster import k-means. You are already familiar with this clustering mechanism, this scikit-learn, from a previous video. I'll provide links to all the k-means clustering videos in the description section below. Now we will be creating the clustering model using the k-means class. And let's say we want to find three clusters from this particular data set. In the fit method, we'll be providing our data, which is currently stored in df. Df is the data frame for which we want to know the cluster assignments. Now we will store a reference of this model in a variable named km. Let's run it. Now km contains the clustering result and additional items. You may recall from a previous video that if we write km.labels and then if we put an underscore, that means if we print km.labels underscore, then we'll be able to see the cluster assignments. So the first row of the data frame df belongs to cluster 0, the second row belongs to cluster 2, the third row belongs to cluster 0, so and so forth. Now this km.labels has 56 entries. Let's check what is the length of this variable km.labels underscore. Oops, it should be labels. So we have 56 entries because df has 56 entries. That means our clustering result will have 56 assignments. Now, one thing we haven't discussed before is how do we know that this clustering result is good or not so good? When we don't have any benchmark data, I like to use average silhouette coefficient or average silhouette score to understand how well the clustering result is. Silhouette score is an evaluation mechanism that will tell us whether our clustering result is good or bad. Silhouette score varies from negative 1 to 1. A score of 0 indicates that the clusters are not representing any good structure. Negative silhouette scores also represent bad clustering. That means the structure is really bad. The more negative the score is, the worse the clustering result is. Any positive scores greater than 0 would indicate that there are some form of structures within the clustering result. The larger the silhouette score is, the better the clusters are. So from sklearn.matrix, this is another folder where we have some functions for evaluation mechanisms. I'm importing the function silhouette score. Something is wrong, and that is here, sklearn matrix. Yes, now it is correct. Very good. For the silhouette score, we need to provide the data, which is in DF, and we need to provide the clustering assignment that we want to evaluate. Then this function, silhouette score, will return us a score. The function is telling us that the silhouette score for the clustering result that is stored in km.labels underscore is 0.64389160231765. Silhouette score can be a maximum of 1. A silhouette score greater than 0 indicates some form of a structure. Here the silhouette score is around 0.64, which is pretty good. That means the k-means clustering algorithm was able to find 3 quite good clusters. I'll provide a link in the description section where, in an article, I described several evaluation mechanisms, including average silhouette coefficient or silhouette score for clustering. Now this result, 0.6438 so and so forth, this particular silhouette score is for 3 clusters. We could run the same algorithm with 2 clusters. So let's remember this score, 0.64. Let's run this same algorithm with 2 clusters and let's keep running the next cells. We see that the average silhouette score is 0.61 for 2 clusters. For 3 clusters, our silhouette score was 0.64. That means for this Pecan dataset, 3 clusters have better structures than 2 clusters. Let's check with number of clusters equal to 4. Let's keep running the next cells and we see that the silhouette score drops even further, which is 0.53. That means still number of clusters equals 3 is giving us the best result in terms of silhouette score. If we keep increasing number of clusters, we see that there is a trend of decreasing silhouette score. So if we make it 6, then it becomes 0.46. If we retrieve 7 clusters, then the score is still around 0.46. If we increase number of clusters to 10, then it's around 0.43. So far, with many different number of clusters, we have figured that the best result appeared with 3 clusters. That means for this data set, our result is the best when we ask for 3 clusters. And at that time, silhouette score is 0.64. Now, sometimes after this result set is created, we prefer to store the result in a file along with the data. So we have DF, absolutely. With DF, we can add a new column with the clustering result. To do that, all we have to do is we have to say DF and we have to provide the name of the new column within square brackets. The name of the new column is, let's say we want to name it cluster IDs. Then we have to say equals. Then we will need to provide the array that contains that particular column that we want to add. Here, the column we want to add is nothing but km.labels underscore. So we can say df in square brackets, we provide the name of the column, and then we provide what the array is in that particular column. So now df is modified. Let's see if that is correct. And notice that we have a lost column which is new, which has the name cluster IDs, and it has the cluster assignments. So in the km.labels array, we have 020012. So we have 020012, so on and so forth. This entire array has been copied here in the cluster ID column. Now, for every row of the data, we have a cluster ID. We have the information in which cluster a row belongs to in this cluster IDs column. Now we probably want to write this new DF, new data frame, with this particular new column. We want to store it in a file. To do that, we have to write df.to_csv. So this to_csv function is used to write the data frame to a file. We have to provide the file name. So let's say the file name is pecanresults.csv. If we press shift enter or shift return, then notice that pecanresults.csv, this file is created here. Let's check. Notice that we have this cluster IDs added. To make sure that this index column is not added, all we have to do is we have to state index equals false. Then let's run the line and let's check the column, and notice that the index column is gone now. We have water per acre, salinity level, fertilizer per acre, pecan yield, and the cluster ID column. Here is the code that we have written today. I will provide a link in the description section that will contain the pecan data and the program we have written today. In this video, we observed that the clustering outcome with three clusters has the highest silhouette score. With a larger K, the silhouette score dropped. For another dataset, you might observe a similar trend. With other datasets, you might observe a different trend. Some might have zigzags before dropping with a larger number of clusters. There are many other mechanisms to evaluate clusters. Please note that whatever evaluation metrics you use, it is always better to look at data points from clusters to check why some data points are in the same cluster and some are in different clusters. Clustering helps us get an initial idea about a dataset. Many times, clustering is used for exploratory data analysis. Stay tuned for more videos on data science and machine learning topics. Subscribe to this channel to receive notifications directly from YouTube when we publish any new video. Happy learning and thank you!